How long have you lived in the house?
I lived there 64 years.
Really?
Wow, that is just amazing.
Yeah.
So you were a young woman when you moved in.
Yeah.
That's really terrific. It's just a beautiful, beautiful home. We're very
the pleased. Location and everything, there's so many wonderful things about it.
Yeah. You know? Well, you know, I'm with Blue Lake.
Yes.
And we're really pleased that we're going to have it.
Well, I'm certainly pleased at what is happening.
Are you?
Yes, I am.
Good.
But even though I felt badly about having to dispose of it, but something had to be done.
Right.
I had to make the decision, but that's the past. I've had wonderful years there.
Well, we hope what we can do is make sure that a lot of people have some wonderful years in the future. Mm-hmm. You know that it's going to become an art gallery.
That's what I understand.
With very high-quality art. Mm-hmm. Just exceptional art. In fact, I've been interviewing people, women and gentlemen who are interested in becoming the director of the gallery, and they all have the same concept here, the same view, that it's going to be just very high quality art. So I hope you'll be able to come and see it when we're all
ready to go. I'm sure I'll be able to. Okay. There's certain things I can do, but I certainly can walk within reason. As long as I don't have to go up and down that hill anymore.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Actually, talking about art, we just walked in. Edna had her first art class.
Oh, and I heard of
it. And then the paintings behind you, which we were totally amazed.
Oh, and this is the very first art class
you've
ever had?
First time she's ever painted.
Well, you have natural talent. Look at that.
We're all astounded.
So you think I should rent the first section.
Well, that's an idea.
Well, good old after all. This is fun, and I'm very pleased to think that I've been accepted in this class because I need something to do.
Now, where is the class?
It's in Muskegon.
At the art museum?
No, don't. Oh. The man used to be an engineer. I really don't know too much about him. He did, he and I did, but he was an engineer and all of a sudden went into one of these art shops. He said he walked in. He was so impressed by this work by Alexander that when he walked out, he had I don't know how many $100 worth of brushes and so forth he took with him.
Huh.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That's very interesting.
It is. So, that's why life is so interesting.
Yes. You meet the people you meet.
Yeah.
Well, I'm very impressed by it. I'll be interested to see. Are you going every week?
Yeah, I'll be going every week.
I love it.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, I have someone who is as enthused as I am, who is also taking lessons, so he will be taking me in.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, and that, of course, transportation is a problem.
It's an issue, isn't it, when you get older?
Yeah, a good friend of Edna's sort of lined her up with this and said, come on and try it. And so she said, sure. Mm-hmm. She did.
That's great.
And then Dave Pam is the gardener who's been working there.
Right. How long have you been there?
4 or 5 years.
4 or 5 years. It's a beautiful area. What we want to do is try to maintain the garden, just as you and your husband did for so many years.
Well, my husband did such a spectacular job. Mm-hmm. No kidding about it. And he loved it. He loved every bit of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love. And it is a beautiful location.
Beautiful location.
Yeah.
We would like, if it's okay with you, we'd like to name the gardens the Bloomdahl Gardens.
Yeah, okay.
And publicize them, put a sign up that says Bloomdahl Gardens and put it in part of our publicity packet for the gallery. Is that okay?
Yes, that's all right.
You wouldn't mind?
Not at all.
Okay. And
I'm very interested in my husband being remembered. Because this is the one thing that I was so pleased when I was given this plaque from the city. That not only I was remembered for being what I did, but that Leonard was included. Because if he hadn't supported me, I couldn't have done a lot of these things.
Okay, there's a picture of Leonard behind the floral bouquet over there.
Yeah, that's his happiest moment when he was...
He had his hat on. He was in the garden when, he,
when
that picture
was
there.
Yeah.
What year exactly was it that you moved in to the house? So we can put that someplace. We'll have a little plaque someplace.
No, must have been about 1935. Because my mother died in 34, and shortly after that.
Mm-hmm. And you moved out last year in 1997?
No, just, well, let's see.
Don't ask me dates. I don't remember.
Don't remember dates.
Now, that's one of the things that happened to me when I had that slight stroke.
Oh, did you have a stroke?
Yeah, and I have I have problems telling time. It's numbers.
I think it would be 1997, because you've been here about a year, haven't you?
Yeah, just about.
So it would be 1997,
so.
Yeah.
Well, we'll put that on the plaque, yeah. You know, any literature that we publish. What we'd like to do if we have an opportunity, we'd like to maybe make a little map of the property and with points of interest in the garden, and then an explanation about how the garden came to be, and a little bit about you and Leonard, and about the house. Mm-hmm. It would be fun to do that, I think. It's a way to get people to come to see the gallery, you know, so.
Well, as Roger is so aware, that when he's had a few people over there to look around, I've always said, well, if you think you're going to do this overnight, it's going to take you 40 years, you know?
Yeah, we know. We're aware of that.
Yeah,
you know, it's just speed of all the garden, right?
Yeah.
And was that house, was your parents' house?
No, it was built by...
Redfern, I think.
Redfern?
Right.
In 1902.
Okay.
And he was, from what I could find out about him, he comes from Claybanks Township someplace or another, that he was a real estate man.
Okay.
And, of course, it is the concrete block, and the concrete block was made by Tiemann
right.
And Monaghan.
Right, right.
Really?
Uh-huh.
Right there in Monaghan.
Right.
Yeah. And was that house ever painted white?
No, it was just the original gray.
The original color, then you painted
the original color of the
block.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you painted.
And we had it sprayed maybe, let's say, 3 or 4 years ago.
Okay.
Oh,
yeah,
I see.
To that.
With the green color.
Yeah, with
the
green
okay.
color.
When Leonard was still alive, you had it?
Yes. Yes.
Because he was gone. She's...
Okay, time again. Right.
If I've been with you, and I'll have to check for sure, I think it's been at least 4 years. And he was gone 4 years before I started.
So
we're talking at least 8 or 10 years
yes.
ago.
Right.
Yeah,
that
would be true.
That would stand to reason, too, because the house is... The paint is peeling now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
that would be about right.
Yeah,
in fact, it needs
repair.
Mm-hmm.
It looks as though there was an addition put on the back of the house.
That is the part that I never can understand about that wooden section
right.
at the back. Now, at the back, there would have been a doorway in there. I have to...
Okay.
Yeah, on that one wall, there was a doorway there so that... Was it one on that back room was used for the old ice box?
Oh.
And there was a coal bin in there, and there was a wood bin in there.
I see.
Was it like a back service porch?
That's yeah, except that it was enclosed.
Mm-hmm. But it was originally.
And then we learned it years later, because all of a sudden we possibly felt that it looked too old.
When you thought of colors for the house, did you think of anything besides green, or how did you happen to come up with green?
When we colored it? No. No, because I happen to have a preference for two colors.
Okay.
Blue or green.
Okay.
Or it has to be a combination of the
two. Okay, all right. All right. I don't know if you have any questions, Dave, or not. I mean, if you just fire away, because Edna's totally open.
Did you replace the furnace, or at any point during the time you lived there, or is that the original furnace?
No, it's at the time when I first moved into the house. I moved into the house because my mother had been very ill and died, and I promised my mother I would take care of my father. Mm-hmm. So after she died, Leonard and I at that time were living on Colby Street, up in one of those houses that had been built up there right near near the greenhouse.
Maybe not.
Oh, up by White Lake Greenhouse.
By White Lake, you know, which is a death. That time was Weezy's.
Oh,
and then so whatever furniture we had in that little house was moved into the big house. We must have sold. You know, you forget just what did happen in that period.
Well, it's 1935.
Yeah. I went to Grand Rapids and bought furniture from Burke and Gaze at that time, and I can remember that I spent $350 to buy the dining room set, the stove in the kitchen, and a couple of rugs and so forth.
So you moved from Colby Street into the
place on Slocum
when your mother passed away.
Yeah.
Right. But see, actually, then we started with the red ferns, but then your parents did move into the house before you moved into the house, right? Your parents lived in that house before you moved in.
Oh, yeah. It was rented.
Okay.
Was rented to somebody or another who was a carpenter. And
then your parents' name, what were your, I forget, Edna, what were your mom and dad's name? What were your parents' name?
Kern.
Kern, right.
K-E-R-N.
Okay, yeah.
Yes.
Did they had a store in Whitehall too, didn't they? Yeah.
That's how we came to Whitehall.
Yeah, they're grocery
by way of Lakewood.
And Leonard had a grocery store also, right?
No, this happened later on. After all, we were the kind of people who stayed at home, you know, and all of a sudden my husband got involved with my father, who had the White Lake Grocery downtown.
Oh, I see.
And the White Lake Grocery would have been in the place of where Gail's jewelry store is right now.
Okay.
And at that time, when we were in that store, it was just when the Masonic Temple was being built in 1921.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's Colby Place.
Mm-hmm. And that's Colby Place. No. Well, then Leonard and I moved in there, and my father had some strange ideas and got remarried again. I don't want to get into that. Because it was a very unhappy situation.
Hmm.
So then by using a little pressure, and I'll be very honest, by using a little pressure, I got him to sign over the property to my husband and I.
Mm-hmm. I see.
And that's the whole story about mm-hmm. that.
Was there any garden then?
No. I mean,
it was just kind of like a house and a piece
no,
of garden.
No, because where the Pacasandra is now, that was all fieldstone. And then there was also a grapevine. In fact, there's still some of that grapevine, isn't there, Ben?
Massive.
That's right.
Massive grapevine.
Yeah. Down on Lake Street.
Down on Lake Street, right. I've cut grapevine out of those cedars, and
that,
some of that stuff
right.
huge.
Yeah.
You
mm-hmm.
can't kill that very easily.
No, that's what I would, because every once in a while when I go out, I find some of that grapevine.
Edna told me that along Lake Street, all those cedars that form a wall there now, mm-hmm. when Leonard first put them in, underneath that ivy and Pacasandra that's down the hill from that, is a rock wall.
Yeah, there's
there are rock steps down there. I've seen the rock steps over in the corner where Slocum and Lake Street come together. Mm-hmm. Very old, rickety little rock steps. And along that top of that stone wall, Leonard used to put in petunias. And of course the cedars, when he put them in, were small.
Sure.
And the reason Leonard put those cedars in is to hide the coal yard down below,
yeah,
right?
Sure.
I mean, there was no marina. There was
no
coal
marina
yard.
At
right.
that time.
Right.
There used to be just an old boat down there where the kids went down there and fished them. In fact, it's amazing the number of younger people that I know now that tell me that that's where they went to
yeah.
fish.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, we could be much more glamorous and say the sewage plant also should be done there, too.
Well, that's all right.
Oh, that's glamorous.
Well, all right, the sewage plant was down there, and we always had to watch the caution light that went on there. And many times, I don't know how many times I called the city to say, the light is on down there, you better go down there and check and see what's going on.
Right. The sewer plant was like right before you went to Crosswinds Restaurant. To
right.
the right, there's now a little yellow building there.
Yeah. So there were reasons to plant what was planted there. You wanted to hide that area from, you didn't want
to hide that area. And then later on, after Leonard put, I don't know, he put in 80 or 90 trees down there.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, he dug up that whole hillside to see that lawn and everything. There wasn't, after all, you did it by hand or you didn't do it in those days.
Mm-hmm.
But originally, we bought these ready made gardens from
a wayside.
Wayside
right.
gardens, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Ready made gardens?
You know, well, they were planned. Gardens,
oh, I see.
You see how times have changed.
Yeah, those aren't available anymore.
Actually, Wayside Garden is still is a it's a very good garden.
The Wayside
catalog.
Is
it's
still
a wonderful garden.
Oh my
catalog.
God, I had a catalog not too long ago.
But
oh,
what
I
they,
what
they but then what they used to do is that they would then say a shade garden, and they would draw, you know, like a right angle, and they'd put like a U and a tree here,
mm-hmm.
some hostas here, and then some stuff over here, and then they'd make a package out of it. And
so that's the way Leonard started learning about gardening?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But then it became a passion for him after that.
Oh.
Yes. A collecting passion. The
yeah.
stories that Edna tells about the number of times they went out and they took a snippet from here and took it home, or they dug up a little plant here, or somebody gave them a rose and they put a jar over it and started a, you know, just all sorts of wonderful stories.
Thank you, Pam. I think that you remember
all. Oh, yeah. The stories you told about you and Leonard going out and collecting, I mean, that was your free time. That was your fun.
Oh, Lordy, that really was.
Bringing in truckloads of, or carloads of rocks, your field
rocks.
Store, you know.
Driftwood off the beach.
Oh, goodness.
Just just delightful.
Yeah.
Did he plant a lot of annuals or not?
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, lots of annuals. In fact, that's the thing I was going to question, whether there's going to be a few annuals, because there are a few of them that should be there, only for looks. Particularly Pam geraniums.
Mm-hmm. Your geraniums.
She knows my love for geraniums and my love for impatience.
Your impatience and your geraniums. Yep.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And so Pam's sitting here. I don't have to tell her because she knows, because we've been through all this.
So she's my resource person. She knows.
Well, I've been so fortunate to have known her. I knew the minute she walked in that she was
the right person.
That she was the right person.
I have gardened for most of my life.
Yeah, I'm just sorry she never knew Leonard.
Mm-hmm.
That they would have been a team.
Right.
But when I'm gardening there, I can feel his presence. You know, certain times I'll start to do something, I think, I shouldn't do this. And I think, thank you, Leonard. You know, it's like, okay. So.
Where have you purchased the annuals?
Mostly at Wheezy's.
Yep. White Lake?
Not White Lake Nursery.
Oh, I see.
Wheezy's.
Out of the river.
Boy, he's got to go out and, my lordy, how many buildings have they added?
Yeah, quite a few.
Mm-hmm.
They're expanding.
Oh, yes. And
eventually, I think they're going to push right on through
to this Weesey family is, by the way, I understand Ed died this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
I heard that, too.
Hmm.
Okay.
But it's one of the things that, after all, if there was a definite need for flowers, I'd be willing to buy them.
You would?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll remember that. Well,
no.
you know that budget is always an issue for an organization like ours, and so I appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
We want to make it beautiful. We want to just try to continue its beauty as long as we possibly can. In fact, we'd like to kind of expand the gardens into the rest of the block. We own the whole block now, you know.
Well, Leonard had started that at one time.
Over toward the Leonard house?
Along the
edge of
the
parking
one
lot.
Side of the theater. And he had just started when all of a sudden Fritz decided that they were going to have Michigan State come in. And at that time I said, Leonard, no way. You're not going to do any more of that landscaping. But he was all ready to landscape that whole lot.
Oh, well, Fritz would have loved that.
So.
Because this is Fritz's mandate. He wants the gardens to be maintained.
I'm glad to hear this. And I need...
It was my idea, but it's his mandate.
Yeah, I know. No, I'm aware of all this. And I just want to be sure that we're all on good terms and that everything can be worked out to everybody's advantage. Because there are things in that house that are very, very unusual. One of the things being that stained glass window, which was evidently taken from an old church up the...
Was it?
Yes, yeah. And put in that window has always been there, as far as I know.
Mm.
And the other thing that is so beautiful are the windows in the house that have the beveled glass and also set in the metal.
In the left.
And
right.
About 4 o'clock in the afternoon, walk in that house, and there are rainbows all over the roof.
I bet that's true.
And it is. It's just beautiful.
Well, we're not going to make any structural changes in the house at all. Mm-hmm. The windows are going to remain. We're going to take up the carpeting mm-hmm. and refinish the floors.
Yes.
There are wooden floors all the way through, aren't there?
Yes, there are.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we'll refinish all of the floors, and then we're going to, in the short term, we're going to repair that ceiling, those ceiling tiles.
Oh, yes. In the dining room.
Right. We'll repair those,
and
but eventually we'll finish.
And what happened there, and so that it doesn't happen again. You know, there's that little porch up there.
Right.
And then somewhere or another, when I had that house re-roofed, they did not fix that one little area on that porch, and that's where the water came through.
Okay. Has it been repaired since?
No, because we could not. I couldn't find anybody who could find the materials to mend that area.
Yeah,
they said those materials were not available anymore because, you see, we had that extra ceiling put in there.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Well, we'll get it fixed.
Yeah.
We've got some pretty inventive people who can work on that stuff.
Actually, Ed, it might be a good question. I mean, as long as Dave is here and they're thinking about things as far as problems or maybe maintenance, was there anything that you would have done in the next 3 or 4 years if you would have stayed there?
Like you know, I've thought about that several times. I don't think so.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
I like the fact that the house was all on one floor.
Mm-hmm.
No, for me, it was perfect.
Mm-hmm.
So.
But I meant like mechanical or just structural or that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Things to fix.
Because there have been new roof on the garage and on the house. And I think those are all on my records that were given to the Best of America. And also the hot water heater was replaced within the last 2 years.
How about the furnace, Edna?
Yeah, the furnace was also replaced. Bordwell did that. He did the hot water heater and the
painting
and the furnace. Yeah, so Bordwell would know exactly. And of course, Bordwell being a local individual.
Right.
Okay. Well, anyway, we're going to repair that ceiling tile.
Yeah.
And then someday, when we can afford it, we'll probably replace the ceilings mm-hmm. to get back to plaster again.
Because that's the only thing when you talk. One of the things we talked about years ago of putting an apartment.
Oh, on the second
floor. On the second floor. And we finally decided we didn't. We had our income was so that we didn't have to depend on an income,
mm-hmm.
and I didn't want anybody over my head.
Well, I think that was a smart decision.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wouldn't want that.
Because there is that nice porch up there with an excellent view.
Right.
Now,
we don't have any plans for the second floor at the moment either. Mm-hmm. We won't do anything for the time being.
I've never been on the second floor. Yeah.
It's pretty short.
Yeah,
okay.
It is. And
it's probably usable.
Not finished off.
Yeah, it could be.
It could be finished. It could be finished off.
It
would be a nice big bedroom kind of mm-hmm. thing. Mm-hmm. You know, one big room would work.
Yeah, we could have a nice big dormitory up there. You know, with four or five beds.
Okay.
The stairway is real narrow going up.
It is steep and narrow, which is pretty traditional for old houses.
Oh, it's a great old house. I just love it. I think it's a great house.
I wonder about the bachelor that built that house. You know?
He was a bachelor?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was a bachelor.
I would like to know who came up with the design. Mm-hmm. Because, now Roger and I were talking about this the other day, and we can't quite figure out what style it is. It's not Victorian, but it's not...
quite a bungalow either.
It's not
a
bungalow either. No, the roof lines are different.
It's in between somewhere, yeah.
I just love it.
Is there anybody from Tiemann's? I suppose not, you know, because that's where the...
The concrete block, yeah. They call that rusticated concrete block when they, because it's, you know, imitates stone.
Yeah, because there isn't anything smooth about it.
Right. Edna also says that, like, when they moved in there, there was, like, in the parking lot in the theater, there was a barn there. Tell them about the story about the theater and then where the parking lot was, there was a barn, right? Mm-hmm. Plus the Lewis house, carriage house, or barn. But
there was it's big. Big.
And you owned the barn too?
Big house in between there.
So there was a house next to the theater and a barn?
Yeah. But there
I don't know.
Was at one time there were two houses on that parking lot.
Wow.
There were two houses on that parking lot. They were boarding houses.
Oh.
Okay.
In there. Hmm. And then at one time the big house, and that was torn down by the man who lived in the Lewis house before it was purchased by Blue Lake.
Okay.
Because as far as I know, the Lewis house was purchased by the priest.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. The priest of what church?
Priest of Blue Lake.
Oh, you're talking about Father Merrick.
Hmm?
Father Merrick out of Blue Lake.
Father Merrick! Because we always wondered where Father Merrick got all the money. Excuse me.
It's a real good question, isn't it?
Sure. No, we always
figured from the old country.
All right. When he came from the old country, he brought over some very unusual antiques and was able to sell them.
Oh, maybe that's what happened.
I mean, after all, it's just these are just natural things.
He was a priest.
Is Father Merrick still alive?
Yes, he is.
Wonderful.
And he's doing very well. He was sick a couple of years ago, but he came out of it, and he's doing wonderfully. He travels all over the world. And
an amazing man.
He was in Czechoslovakia last summer and to visit family, you know.
I know he was always very, very important.
I don't know how old he is. He's in his, easily in his 80s. His late 80s, I would guess. I don't know.
I would think so.
I haven't seen him in a while. I'll see him next week.
Oh.
Mentioned that I had talked with you.
Yeah, I'm sure Father Merrick could remember me.
Oh, I'm sure.
So.
Yeah.
So.
What, he bought the house before Blue Lake bought it?
Hmm?
He bought that Lewis house before Blue Lake bought it?
Yeah, well, I think he bought it for Blue Lake.
Hmm.
I mean, this is all questionable. It was only what you're hearing that's happening.
Hmm.
You know.
He might have acted on Blue Lake's behalf.
Now, it could have been.
Or it could be money that he donated to Blue Lake, because I know that he
That, I think, sounds more like.
But he was there right at the very beginning of Blue Lake.
Yeah.
Back in 1966.
You see, and that Lewis house has been destroyed. It's not the nice place that it was years ago, because all of a sudden they changed it to use it for certain rooms, and a lot of things been added in there.
Well, you
the
know,
porch,
when they,
the porches were taken off. And,
but that's what, they bought it that way. Blue Lake, when Blue Lake bought it, it had already been modified.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And we have
for a long time it was used by
the rooming
by
house.
A group of women who made the Christmas ornaments.
Oh.
And that became quite a big deal, this Christmas ornament thing. Wait, the person you talk to about the Christmas ornaments is Harriet
Roman. Right, okay.
Yeah. Because and on top of that, then that group got together and did the Centennial Cookbook.
Did they do that? Was that done for Blue Lake? Who was that done for?
No, that was done for as a local.
But like the Christmas ornament.
That was done when Louis Berman was the editor of the Whitehall Forum.
But who did the Christmas ornaments? Was that, were the Christmas ornaments in conjunction with Blue Lake?
No.
They just did it.
I guess they were sold because it was Blue Lake. But not, oh wait. I think that's the thing you have to find out from Harriet, how much money she gave to Blue Lake.
I hesitate to ask Harriet about this.
I think that's the story there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did all these women that owned this house and sold these ornaments, did they have a club? Was there a name of
that
club?
Yeah, a group that everybody met every week.
At the house.
Yeah, at the house.
But the house was owned by Blue Lake, right?
Yeah, the women
went to work there.
Yeah, and we used the back part of it, which would have been the kitchen and the restrooms and so forth. And then at Christmas time, the house would all be decorated for Christmas.
Okay.
And also, they would always serve spiced cider.
Okay.
I wonder if maybe that was before Blue Lake. It's possible that Blue Lake was involved in that, but my guess is it was probably before Blue Lake.
Well, in some small way that I think that Blue Lake allowed us to use the house.
Oh, I see. That would make some sense.
Yeah, I think that might be.
Yeah, they would do that.
Yeah, that's right. Because we used to have meetings there.
It's a great old house.
Oh.
I would love to be able to redo that house.
Yeah, we'll go through that. I'd like to go through it.
I'll get a key and take it through.
Yeah.
It's a fabulous old house. And it's been, since Blue Lake has owned it, it's been maintained. It hasn't been improved.
No.
But it's been maintained. In fact, we're going to have it painted again this year.
Yeah.
And we've put a new furnace in it.
Oh, there were so many things that needed to be done.
Oh, I know. It's still that way.
Michigan State came in and there were no showers and so forth, a couple of the young men would come to our house and use our shower.
Well, that was hospitable to let them do that. I wouldn't have let them do it, I don't think.
Beats running to the hose, right?
Well.
Now, there's so many interesting things about just that small section there. Mm-hmm. One of the other things, as Roger, I was thinking about, that after all, when we bought that lot, which was later used for the parking,
mm-hmm.
that was bought from Duttenhofer.
Okay.
And Duttenhofer was part of
Michelin de Beach.
Michelin de Beach Lodge.
Lodge, right.
Oh.
Who also had a piece of property up the street there in the house in that block where Pitkins used to live. Where Everett G. lives in that block now, where Piccadilly's.
Oh, yeah. That's the house, one of those houses, that house is being.
They're now working on it.
Remodeled.
Right.
On it. That's right.
Yeah.
And so it's amazing that here they were from one end of the lake to the other.
Yeah. Huh.
Yeah.
They had the houses and the property, or was it vacant then?
At that time, no, there were two boarding houses.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
And they had them torn down?
Yeah, they were torn down.
Before you bought the property?
No, when we bought the property, why did we buy it? Duttenhofer came to us and said, I'd like to sell you the lot. And I said, we haven't got any money. Well, I need $900. So I said to Leonard, well, let's see what we can do. So we did.
$900.
Right.
Couldn't buy a piece of property for $900 now.
Pay the taxes.
As we know.
Pay the taxes.
As we know. I heard that there might be a problem with water in toward the back door, that there might be a standing water problem back there. Is that true? Where the cement...
In the breezeway.
In the breezeway, between the back door and the garage. Do we have a standing water problem there when it rains?
What do you think?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do have
it. Doesn't really stand. It drains away sooner or later, right?
But where does it drain to?
Through cracks in the cement, which is eroding the earth out from underneath.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
So that's an issue we'll have to deal with sometime. Okay. Something else that we're trying to do, I don't know if we'll be able to do it or not, is we're trying to get a designation from the state to make the house a historical... You help me. What do you call it?
Historical landmark.
That takes a little time.
But we're making the application now for that. So there may be a plaque established there.
Mm-hmm.
That would be nice.
That'd be nice.
Because it is. It's a unique home.
And actually, I mean, the city could even go further than that, because there's the Staples house across the street, which is much more historic than like Edna's house. And then, I mean, there's the theater, which is historic in itself. I mean, there's almost a district there.
You see, part of that Staples house goes back to 1965.
18, right, okay.
Yeah. 1860.
Yeah, and of course with those several buildings there. Hmm. It's a very, very interesting house. But it isn't the interesting house that the Blumenthal house, and neither is the other house on the other corner. It isn't as interesting. Doesn't have the windows and everything.
The Staples.
Your house is very unique.
Yeah.
It's very,
yeah, it
very
is.
Unique.
Yeah.
Well, Fritz came to me and said, Mrs. Blumenthal wants to sell her property, and what do you think? And I said, we have to buy it. And he said, well, tell me why we have to buy it. I said, first of all, it's a great investment for us, because then we would own the entire block. Mm-hmm. And secondly, it's a great old house. We can find something to do with that. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, find something to do with that. And he gave me 1 week. So I thought about it for about a week, and he called up. He said, now you have to tell me, what are we going to do, because I have to convince the board that we want to spend $140,000 for this house. And I said, well, I've been thinking about it. I said, I think we should put an art gallery in there. Mm-hmm. And he said, I think that's perfect. He said, but it has to be just great art. He said, I don't want any arts and crafts things, he said. So we're all in agreement. All we have to do is sell.
Are we keeping up the theater?
Yes, actually, we've spent a lot of money on the theater in the last several years.
Yeah, all right. I'm aware. I'm aware of all that. But, you know, that happens to be one of the things I'm very interested in.
The theater.
Yeah, because I would love, I'm going to say it right now, I would love to see it come back to where it doesn't say Ahmed on it. That it says Milford Adams.
Right.
We were talking about that.
See, I did not feed that to Edna.
Very important.
Yeah.
At the time, I was on the advisory board, mm-hmm. and we had to make that decision because how it was, we needed money to refurbish the theater, because I can go back to the time when we bought the seats for the theater and had them all in Harriet's garage so we could go down and check on them and sure see they were all right, honestly. Now, Frank Adams was a marvelous man, wonderful producer. Mm. He had five plays going in Chicago at one time that were all successful. And of course, he's the man who is so noted. I wonder who's kissing her now.
Right, that's what Roger's
doing. Yeah, that's the history is great.
Would you say that theater was very successful back in the 40s?
Of course, we went. Originally, when I first came here, was a movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
Wait a minute. First, we had Wilkie in there, and then Carter. When Wilkie was in there, Wilkie used the basement and made refurbished fur coats and so forth. And he's the one who sold it to Fritz, because Fritz came to me and asked me whether I could make arrangements to talk to Wilkie.
I see.
Yeah. Hmm.
Was it named the Haumette Playhouse? When was it named the Haumette Playhouse?
Well, it would have been in that period when Haumette, well, would have been when Haumette first came in.
Well, they gave a donation. I wasn't here right now, but like they gave a donation, a significant donation, didn't they?
They gave a donation and
to purchase
to help to assist in the purchase of it, right?
Right.
I mean, there was
also we had a drive at the same time.
There was community money, just
at
large.
No, because there should maybe I see. I haven't been to the theater recently, but there used to be a plaque, and on the far wall, as you go in, on the right-hand side, that gave some of the names on that plaque. Mm-hmm. I can remember just going out and trying to get $100 from each one to refurbish the theater.
Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of community money, but then I think, did Haumette give like $10,000 or what? Does
something like that, yeah.
And that's when they decided.
And that's why it's the Haumette Theater.
Yeah, yeah.
But I would love to see it go back to the new Fred Adams, because after all, Frank had been in Germany in the World War, and that's where he had seen a theater identical to the Playhouse.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, with this wonderful acoustical on that stage.
Mm. There's something about the backstage that does something.
It's got a curved backstage, which is very unusual.
I know, and they've almost torn it out several times.
Oh, it's hard to maintain. We're fixing the
air
roof
conditioning,
again.
The basement, everything.
Yeah. The roof is being fixed again right now. We had a leak there, another big leak last month. So that's being fixed again. And in fact, they're going to replace a big section of the roof. And
you mean just the coating or structurally?
The coating.
Yeah.
We put, tens of thousands of dollars in lighting equipment in last year.
Yeah, a lot of
lighting equipment. We've rewired a lot of it so it's safe, which is good, because all of that wiring is so old.
Oh, my gosh.
And the last 2 years we've spent a lot of money on just electrical things. Mm-hmm. So it's sound now, and we got a new curtain. We got a new curtain for the stage, brand new, and we need to deal with some of the color scheme at this point, but we're working on it.
Also, I mean, Dave, you told me like how much money they have like actually lost or how much you spend. I mean, maybe you should run that by Edna just to kind of just give her some reality.
This is not something we brag about.
I know, okay.
But since it became part of Blue Lake, we've put over $1 million into it. Lost over $1 million on the project. Mm-hmm. We lose annually. We average about $35,000 in losses.
Yeah, that I can readily believe.
So it's difficult. But the camp is always trying to make it work. And the last season was very good. I mean, we lost about $22,000 last year, which was one of the better years we've ever had. And we've got our theater, the guy who's running the theater is from Andrews University.
Is he from South Bend or Benton Harbor, somewhere down that area? Or?
Yes, Andrews University.
I've met him. He's a nice man. Yeah.
He's very nice, and he's very good. He seems to be very, he's caring, and he seems to have a real interest in doing it. And he knows a lot of good people. And attendance was pretty good last year.
Yeah, so. I've heard that they've just done Grease and something else, and you had good attendance.
I saw that last Friday, as a matter of fact. Jim Lois Rose's son was the lead. Mm-hmm. Matt was the lead, which was sort of strange. You sit there and watch these little kids and you remember their grandparents, you know.
The theater, is, to me, has been a very important part of the community.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always supported it in any way that I could. And I would certainly like to see it continue under these circumstances.
That's the point.
And it did very well when Michigan State was here that year.
Boar's Head Theater?
Some things went. Once in a while, there's something that goes wrong, but that isn't. And
well,
I do know that the number of those people that were. All right, I'm still hearing from people who were here at Michigan State. In fact, funny, I'm just looking at something in my drawer here and realizing that I am still hearing from those same people because we made such good friends.
Is that right?
And
that's right. The same people came back year after year, didn't they?
That's right.
And you'd
for
see
about
them
5 years.
And you'd see them in different roles. It was great fun just to see them doing, you know, the good guy, the bad guy,
mm-hmm.
the whatever. Yeah.
Well, Michael's. I hear from Michael's family all the time. In fact, I just heard from the Pinders, which is another group that were always here, and they tried their best to make some sort of a proposal, but evidently you never quite made it.
I'm not very familiar with the history of that
yeah.
time frame. I know there were problems. I don't recall what
well,
they were.
Well, so everybody has problems.
I think there was a financial situation. I think the people at no, I better stop because I don't know the whole story. I know there was a problem of some sort, but I don't
but
recall
there was this great period of when they went through of having so many big names come into camp.
Yeah.
And all these things were something for the community.
Mm-hmm.
Possibly, you know, maybe the community wasn't quite ready.
I think that's probably,
and
there's a lot
to
be said for that. Fritz has said that in the past. We lost so much money over some of those things. You know, when we bring the big names in,
yeah.
we lost so
oh
much money.
Oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. The last year we did that, which was probably 7 or 8 years ago, that year we lost $70,000
mm-hmm.
at the camp that one summer. Just we brought like 3 or 4 big names in, and we just lost our shirts.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided not to do that anymore.
Right.
But
right.
you know, we still have concerts every weekend, and even during the week up there,
yeah.
all summer long. You know, and it's amazing how many people just don't know about it or don't care
yeah,
about it.
That's exactly it.
So.
And of course, after all, Fritz was so anxious with the music show in Whitehall too, and then it didn't get put in the right space.
Oh, but is that right?
I don't know. It was just lots of.
Where was it going to go, Edna?
Hmm?
When you say that, where was it supposed to go?
Certainly on the opposite side of the. See, it's on the Montague side.
Oh, it was supposed to be on the Whitehall side.
But where were they going
side?
To? Where were they going to put it?
I don't know, but they had some idea. After all,
I don't know. I was gone during that time,
yeah.
so everybody don't know. I wasn't aware that it was, huh?
That may
because that's
that
why
rivalry.
Hmm.
Well, what we'd like to do, what I'd like to do, is I'd like to have the three of us work up some plans for the garden and then come back here and show you what we have planned,
okay.
if that's okay with you.
I think that would be wonderful.
And then we can get started. We're
all
not
right.
taking possession of the house until May 1st, I think. And then, so we can't work on anything
yeah.
until after that, but.
I'm wondering, because there's a lot of work that should be going on in the garden now. Stuff is, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's the ownership issue at this point. We really can't do anything until we own it, you know.
Okay.
So.
I'll talk with them.
Why don't you do that?
Pam, are you willing to go along with all this?
Oh yeah, I think it's exciting. I just think it's wonderful.
In the meantime, is Weesey still taking care of the mowing and so forth that needs to be done? Because
no,
all of a sudden we've had
a
lot of rain. That's
right.
What I'm thinking.
Right, and that's what I need to talk with you about, because technically you're still the owner.
Yeah.
So nobody's doing anything at all.
Mm-hmm.
Until the 1st of May.
And there is work that needs to be done there in this next month until Blue Lake takes it over May 1st. So I'll talk with you about about that.
Please.
Yeah, because I think
you two get your heads together to be sure it is kept up, because all of a sudden, boy, this
the
spring
stuff,
so
right.
A month can make a
right.
lot of difference in,
right.
in
right.
a garden that,
yep.
that fast, yes, definitely. I'll come and talk with you tomorrow. I'm going to be in town
okay.
tomorrow.
Who was doing the mowing and caring for the lawn and the sprinkler system?
White Lake.
Nursery.
Because you've kind of coordinated that, haven't you? Coordinated that, right.
I work with them.
Yeah.
No, because they have checked the water and all that sort of thing.
No, it's been too early to do that, Edna.
Well, I got
okay,
a call,
but,
actually.
What I'm thinking is they would.
This week.
Because they put the watering system in there, and they check it every so often. I've lost track of many things they've done.
Mm-hmm.
And
but you say you're May 1, and we're now April 2.
Right.
So we had a hot spell, now we're having a cold spell, but you know, in a couple of weeks it may pick up again, and
right.
then Pam would kind of want to get going, so maybe, you know, Pam can talk to you, and then you can talk to the bank and say, arrange to have Pam
yeah,
paid during
the... I don't want things to get,
no.
get
right.
out of hand.
Right, right.
We'll clarify that
right.
tomorrow
yeah.
when
yeah.
we meet with her, and also
yeah.
any, like, turning the sprinkling system on and setting that up and stuff, and that will be done within this next month, so...
Okay.
Yeah.
Under the auspices of Edna's ownership.
Okay. And then we'll just take over on the first
take
day.
Right.
That sounds good. That
okay.
sounds good.
And then the reverse, Dave, that somehow she knows what to do when November comes around or October comes around.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good.
I mean, did you, during your ownership, did you have any plans about who was going to take care of the lawn part of it? Because I don't do lawns.
No. We were planning on contracting that out, so we can continue as long as the price is reasonable. I asked I'm sorry, I don't remember the name. This woman called and said that she'd been working, you know, on the property for a long time, and I assume it's what the Weeseys or.
Well, I don't know.
This woman said, and she said, I said, just if you could give me a quote, on maintenance of that property, plus add the rest of the lot to it, and let's find out what the whole. Price would be
yard
for
maintenance?
Is this
yeah.
for grass or what?
Grass.
Boy, there hasn't been a woman working there. Not
well, maybe somebody from the
it
office.
It may have been a woman from the office, yes.
My guess is that's what it was.
Weesey's. Okay.
But anyway, they're going to give us a quote and then we'll work from there. And
good.
We want to try to spruce up the entire block.
Right.
Yeah.
That'll be interesting to see, to actually walk through there and see.
The Lewis house is, we're talking about paint in the Lewis house. Actually, I want to talk to you about that too, but we can't afford like 14 different
right,
colors
right,
of paint,
right.
but we're thinking lighter, certainly much lighter than what we've got on there now, and if you have any notion on that, that would be good.
Because
Heidi,
you know,
brought it up
yesterday. One thing I'd like to say here is when it comes to like, when you're going to do the rest of the block, that sounds wonderful. At the same time, that makes me rather nervous. Because like, and then this is where we got into like, the garden, like the difference between like Leonard's gardening skills and Leonard's gardening eye versus the maintenance people's eyes. And I'm like, yeah, to me, you're a gardener, you're not a maintenance person, all
right?
Right. And that somehow the maintenance people, they're very cruel on landscape. And you know, and the garden there is not a it's done by love, not by cruelty, and that somehow when and if you do some things around like the Lewis house, like quite frankly, I would love to, you know, make a plant list or do something involved in that versus the maintenance people doing that, because you'll have fun little balls all on the ground.
No, I agree with you completely. You know, it's not going to just be...
You have to be very, very careful.
The guy who mows the lawn,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That's not the plan.
And yet also, like, I've seen the crews from Blue Lake come out and do the raking.
Right.
Out in there, and we'll have to make sure that they understand areas that they can rake and areas that they can't rake. Because you know? I won't let Weezy's rake in the flower beds. I say, you can rake the lawn, but... Not the flower beds, you know, and I have to specify
and you come,
when I
and you come by and do that. You take care
exactly.
of
exactly. I take care of the flower beds because they. I mean, those are they're young kids. They're out there just or
right.
or all they're doing is raking leaves. You know, mm-hmm. they're not aware that there are already some things up, and you don't right. want to break the heads off the peonies. Right. You know, that are coming up. So that's what you're doing.
Yeah. They just you know, they're not
planning in anticipation of who's going to be doing what where, and that's okay. real important. And I think you and I. Are pretty clear on those kinds of things, mm-hmm. and if you're not, then you need people like us, and we can work it all out and
right. stuff that up. One thing we always have to keep an eye on is the budget here.
I understand
so.
That. Right. Okay. I understand that.
Right.
Anyway, why don't you, one of the three of us, get together sometime over
okay.
there,
okay.
and we can talk about more specific things maybe next week.
Yeah.
And would that be okay with you?
Is late in the afternoon good for you?
Sure.
We could even set up.
I can. Arrange my schedule.
Okay.
I'm pretty flexible. I don't have my calendar with me at the moment, but I can tell you that there. Roger and I can maybe talk.
Well, if you have Pam's, I don't know. Do you want to play with a date?
Sure.
Or do you want to call later on, or what do you want?
Why don't you pick a date, and I'll try to clear. I can tell you that Tuesday and Thursday are really bad, but Wednesday morning would work for me.
Wednesday's bad for me.
Okay.
Monday and Friday then are open.
Monday's okay for you. Monday's fine with me. We can do it middle of the afternoon, 3, 4.
3, 4, or first thing in the morning.
Monday morning is not good for me. I have meetings.
Let's do 4.
Okay.
That doesn't cut too much into my work time on that.
Shouldn't take too long to.
Okay. Kind of and meet right there at Edna's house.
Okay.
Now who has the keys?
That's
the
6.
You don't yet, do you?
No, Mr. Rose has the keys. The attorney. I don't think we'll probably go into the house unless you feel it's necessary.
No, we're not going.
Okay. And then we can kind of get some thoughts. We have to deal with some issues in the front because it's really overgrown there. We need to work on it. We have to have a handicap ramp going in, but I have some ideas with that maybe could blend right into the garden so
mm-hmm.
it doesn't
mm-hmm.
even look like a handicap
mm-hmm.
ramp.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think maybe put some brick walkways through so that when people are walking into the garden, they're not trampling the grass. And
some of the areas of the grass, especially on that slow part, the grass
almost
is
almost treacherous.
It is.
Yeah.
And you walk on it or pull a cart across it, and the grass is gone. It's just gone.
Oh.
So there are some things. Yeah, there's some.
So we can kind of look at those
mm-hmm.
kinds
sure.
of things.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Well, what do you think, Edna? We'll meet over there next. We're going to meet over there next Monday. We'll talk more about the garden over there, and we'll get back to you.
Sounds wonderful.
Okay, you feel good about this? Okay.
No, sounds good, and it's exactly the way I'd like things done. I had no idea that I was going to be able to see this done, but it is.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I think it's the right decision. At this point.
I like it. I mean, the Blue Lake Art Gallery and the Bloom Dole Garden, I mean, you know,
mm-hmm.
it's a great combination.
I like it that you're going to have a whole block. I think that's wonderful.
Well, I think it's going to be very exciting. We have some... We're going to try some long-term things that some ideas that I can't discuss at the moment, but it'll be interesting. It's all dependent on whether the gallery works, and... I think it's going to. I think it has the potential of being very successful. For one reason, and I was talking to a woman who was very interested in the position, there are no other galleries to speak of, any fine art galleries north of Grand Haven or south of Pentwater. I mean, we're it. We would be it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want people who live in Muskegon or Fremont or Whitehall or any of this area, if you want people who know art to have a place to go, we're the logical place. And we've got those names already because we have access to those lists. So I think it's probably doable. If it works, then we've got some other ideas that we can play with. So.
Well,
one thing we want to do is...
Things are moving so fast. We have to think for the future and hope to hold people here in one way or another.
Yeah.
And I do know that the number of people that took time to go to the sale were all so complimentary to me about they had no idea what a beautiful house that was. In fact, it's kind of interesting. My friend Irene Kelly, and you know that is a beautiful place down there at Lawrence Bend.
Mm-hmm.
My friend Ann Henyon did a little review down there with Irene a little while ago because there was some help needed. And Ann said to me afterwards, I had no idea how beautiful your house was compared to, and of course that's in such a gorgeous location beside that waterfall.
She's talking about the Lion's Den going down South Shore Drive.
Yeah. It's just interesting that all of a sudden Anne was aware that these big houses
this one and that
so
one, right?
Between these big houses.
Yeah, it was a whole different garden setup. I mean, you know, you just had the slope garden, the exposure, the lake view, and then the other one has, like, it has space and lawn and waterfall.
Yeah, and of course, at one time there was that wonderful rose garden, but when Larry died, that I tore up because I knew I'd never...
Where was that?
Had I known I was going to have a gardener like Pam...
Where was the rose garden?
At the Lion's Den.
Just down on the side, you know.
Towards where the
originally had been up where the rhododendron is now.
I see.
She's talking about Leonard's rose.
Oh, I see. Okay, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So there were a few changes along the way.
But then, you know, along the way also, like, Leonard was good friends of, like, Bill Gebhardt. And he was and the landscape connection in the land, he was connected to kind of like the landscape world. He knew those people, didn't he?
Yeah. Well, you know, at the time that Kent's started to do that place down at Michelinda, and Leonard and I had just decided to retire out of business, and somebody said, well, they needed a gardener doing there, so Leonard went down there. So he went to Bill Gebhardt.
Okay.
Bill Gebhardt made a possible plan for $100.
Whoa, okay.
Those were the good old days, right? You can't do that now.
I
can't
lot for
$900.
Yeah.
Okay.
I see, so then he was the gardener there. He worked in the garden down there.
Oh, yeah, sure. He did a lot of the planting down there and gave Evelyn Kent the marvelous background that she's got now.
Mm-hmm.
See, there's that 40 years.
Matter of fact, that's something, Dave, like, if you have some time sometime, when the Kent garden gets going, we should call them and take a walk. That's a long driveway.
Oh,
have you been
with
him in the camp?
Yes, she took me there once.
Okay, it's a driveway garden.
Season, yeah.
And it's just very, like, you know, I'll say it's 900 feet long by 100 feet wide or something.
Mm-hmm.
And you go way back in, there's a house, it's like around the bluff. But it's a garden you drive through or walk through. And it's very interesting. Mm-hmm. Great plant selection.
It really is. It's fun to go there.
Right. Oh, I see.
Yeah, right next to it, yeah.
I'd like to see that.
Yeah. Well, okay.
Well, thank you very much for letting us come over and talk
with
you.
Well, I'm so glad you came because you gave me some good feelings for the future and know that some of the plans that Leonard made years ago are going to be worked out, mm-hmm. and he'd be very pleased. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, we're very pleased that we can do this. And I've been at Blue Lake for 10 years now, and it's a wonderful place to work. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad I have the opportunity to do this project. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Now, was Margaret still alive when you were there?
No.
Fritz's mother. She was a wonderful woman.
Was she?
Oh, the way she kept that cafeteria.
She had it going, didn't she?
Wow!
Yeah.
And the same way with Fritz's father.
Yeah.
He was wonderful. They are so important in our community. They
the
really
Stancils,
are.
The Stancil family?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think they've done a lot for.
Well, you know, there's so many things that are so important. The other thing is the scout camp is so important, mm-hmm. in our community.
Right.
It's meant so much.
I think a lot of people in Whitehall and the White Lake area don't realize
that.
No. I don't think they do.
No. I don't think they realize it.
I don't think so.
I'll tell you that Blue Lake has been criticized time and time again by people in the White Lake area.
Yeah, I know.
Well, selfishness for not giving use of the Haumette Playhouse for free. A lot of people think that they should just be able to use it, and we can't. We just can't. It costs money to run the place, you know.
That's right.
So we've been criticized for that, and well. For,
yeah, no,
for the
but
House
the criticism has been, seems to me I'm always at the other end. I say, well, after all, it's somewhere or another that the city couldn't begin to take over that place. They never could have spent that amount of money to have kept that building.
Right. Well, we're going to keep working on it.
Uh-huh. See, it's interesting, Dave, because like Edna would have been. Were you in the city council when all that was going on?
A lot of this.
Yeah. And so when she says, like, the city would have and couldn't have.
She knows.
Yeah, that's right. It wasn't, the votes weren't there, I'm sure.
Yeah. I think that's probably still the case.
Mm-hmm.
That the city couldn't maintain it.
Right.
Yeah. And they wouldn't have the artistic. We're talking about a city council.
That.
You know, we're not talking about
the contacts
the
and
right.
And the vision.
Yeah, exactly.
I think, you know, with your owning that block, and if you're interested in doing a landmark, and there's a potential for a landmark district, there's a whole thing that could happen all the way down to Piccadilly's kind of thing, back to the big oak tree. I want to call it the one G house on that side of the Staples house.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
That property through there.
There's a couple of those oak trees. I hope they don't cut down.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be good, wouldn't it? Just to have markers all up and down that area with a map.
Well, I'm not saying necessarily a land. You have to have markers, but you do a district. It's a special review district. So
what does that mean in terms of like taxes or, you know, grants?
It doesn't mean a lot,
Dave.
There's not that much to go around. I mean, if you went to the state, then they would say the same way Blue Lake is talking, you know. We barely make it kind of thing, you know.
Sorry,
I've got to go. This was a recording that was done on April 2, 1998. Are Dave Myers from Blue Lake Radio. Blue Lake Radio is about to purchase the Bloomdahl House. Then there's Edna Bloomdahl, the owner, legendary Edna, and then also Pam Lewis, who was the very visionary gardener that Leonard and Edna had working on the property for a long time. Also myself, Roger Scharmer, and we're discussing basically what could evolve if Blue Lake bought the property for an art gallery, and then also we get into talk about the Playhouse, Frank Adams, the Lewis House, and other aspects of that whole block and maybe even a potential historic district, things like that. Anyway, interesting discussion, and that's it.